Good morning, sir. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for the very generous introduction, sir. It is always an honor to speak in front of such experienced legends like yourself. Professor Emilio is here, Professor Selina, Pillai sir, Dr. Pillai sir from Gujarat, Dr. Aman sir, Dr. Priyanka, so many of you senior experienced experts over here. So it is an honor and thank you for inviting me, IISR and AFOL, for being a speaker at this event. So let us just begin without any further delay. I'd like to share my presentation. I hope you can see my screen.
Yes, ma'am, it is visible.
Okay. All right. So I would like to speak about today some of the challenges we face in human identification from a forensic odontology perspective. I am sure many of you have attended so many webinars in the past 1 year, and I would not like to repeat what you have already heard, because I'm sure you know the basics. In this talk, I would like to talk about more about the local challenges we face, being from India, where forensic odontology is comparatively not that developed, or we don't find dental records easily. So what are the challenges we face working in India, and some challenges which are universal in nature, and every forensic odontologist around the world would face them. Let us begin a little bit by brushing up regarding what are the different kind of identifiers, and then we go into the challenges faced. So you all know this, basically the responsibilities of forensic dentists. Now these are just some major responsibilities a forensic odontologist can do, and does do a lot more than this, especially in the field of research. This I have written down from the practical aspects. These are some of the major responsibilities we work on. Identification of found human remains. These could be single human remains or in mass fatalities. Dental profiling of unknown remains, or you can say biological profiling of human remains, especially skeletal remains from cold cases. Then we have dental age estimation. Forensic odontologists are a part of the age estimation panel. So most of the times there is a team of experts who does age estimation, and a forensic odontologist is a part of that team along with the forensic medicine expert, a radiologist, a gynecologist. So he's a part of the team. Then bite mark analysis or assessment of cases of abuse. So when there are patent injuries, and to identify accidental injuries or intentional injuries, forensic odontologists may be called upon. Dental anthropology and archaeology, dental malpractice and negligence. Owing to the legal knowledge a forensic odontologist possesses, because of his training and because of the nature of the work he does, there are times when he is also involved as an expert in cases of dental malpractice and negligence. Most of the times we need to identify dental remains. In India, there is, most of the times visual identification is done if the body is intact and it is fresh. Many people, they die at home owing to a long-term illness, or they may die in a hospital after being, treated for a long-term illness. So for these people, it is not considered a requirement to use identifiers. Most of the time, these people are identified by visual identification, because they have died in front of their loved ones, in front of their families. But if the remains are decomposing, skeletonized, charred remains, then most of the time, a primary identifier is required. In such cases, dental identification can prove to be very useful. Besides this, if there are intact remains where there is no putative victim, so we don't know who it is at all. When there is a need for scientific verification as a formality, so in cases where there is a large insurance settlement involved, so in such cases, dental identification can be done for scientific verification. Where multiple bodies are recovered from a common location to assure correct sorting and mass disasters. So, according to the rules, or you can say the guidelines laid down by the Interpol, the primary techniques for identification are DNA, fingerprints, dental, and unique medical records. So these three are considered to be the primary identifiers. Also, unique medical records such as implants, or it could be any implant, like a hip implant, or implants from a knee replacement surgery, or a pacemaker. All these things can serve as unique medical records. Secondary identifiers. Also, there are n number of secondary identifiers, and it is not in the scope of this lecture to cover all of them. These are some of the major ones which we come across, regularly in routine cases. So we have tattoo marks, scars, then monogrammed clothes, or needle puncture marks. It could be a diabetic because of the insulin injections, scars, and tertiary identifiers, which can only provide a lead. Okay, so tertiary identifiers cannot be used as a final or a confirmatory method of identification, but they just provide lead in cold investigations. So superimposition, it is a good technique for exclusion. Reconstruction only provides a lead when there is nothing else available. So this can be, we can try it. No harm in trying it. So it is that kind of a method. It can provide lead, and which can later be confirmed by a primary identifier such as DNA or dental or fingerprints. So it has been proved to be very useful in the region where I work in India, in Mumbai city. It has helped a lot in cracking some cold investigations. And now we are slowly shifting to digital techniques. Let me talk a little bit about dental records for the sake of the students who are here today. Dental records, you all know, these are written records, or now it can be typed in a digital format. So these are basically the clinical records. Okay, they are not made from the point of view of forensics. They are made for the purpose of clinical work, and they are very useful even in cases where there are allegations of dental malpractice and negligence. Dental records are the first line of defense for the dentist. So, and they have been very useful for forensic dentists as well. There are many difficulties associated with accessing these dental records when we deal with forensic ID cases. In India, there is no one database to store all dental records. Everyone goes to a private dentist most of the time, and every dentist has their own method of preserving or not preserving dental records. Ideally, they are supposed to preserve dental records. Many times I have seen dentists in my city where they give the radiographs back to the patient and they don't preserve it with themselves in the clinic, and the patient may misplace it, or they may keep it in sometimes, but they may misplace it, and sometimes the family members don't know where the records have been kept by that person. So it is very difficult to access such dental records. And this is a very good question some people ask to forensic odontologists, that if you have to use dental records to identify a body, how do you know which dentist to ask? So how to trace a dentist? Now, in more developed countries, it is I have worked in the UK. My post graduation is from UK, so I know that there the police traces the dentist, and they are the ones who are responsible for procuring these dental records. In India, it is possible that you might, as a forensic odontologist, you might have to do it. So these are just some tips which are useful. So first is you talk to the family, co-workers or friends. Many times people don't say at home, but they talk to their colleagues at work, and they may know who the dentist was. Inquire if the individual was treated or consulted a dental specialist. So it is possible he went to an orthodontist when he was younger. So they may have some records from the past. Inquire if the individual had a dental insurance plan, a union dental plan, or any other benefits. This could lead to a dentist name from the records. Examine military and prison records. You can take the help of investigating agencies, police for this. Examine medical records to see if the physician has a record of the name of the dentist. Okay, sometimes it might be the person might be suffering from a complicated illness, and it is possible that the physician and the dentist were in touch for the same. In a small community, it may be necessary to contact all dentists and inquire if they have treated that individual. So many times I have seen, especially in rural parts of India, in villages where there is just one dentist in that entire area, or one or two or three dentists in that entire area, it is much easier to contact all of them and quickly find out if that person went to those dentists. So in smaller communities, it is easier to directly approach the dentists who are already working there. Now, let us talk a little bit about postmortem examination of dental remains. In certain circumstances, examination can begin at the site where the body was found, or a return trip may be warranted. A forensic odontologist may be able to help locate and identify dental remains that are decomposed, charred, or dramatically mutilated. Some of the fragments may appear to be burnt pieces of wood or other debris. So a forensic odontologist, many times people feel that what is a forensic odontologist going to do at the crime scene? We'll get the, you know, you can examine the teeth at the mortuary, or you know, if you can come to the autopsy suite and examine the teeth. You don't have to come to the crime scene. But it should be noted that fragmented teeth which are burned or mutilated remains, in those cases, it is the forensic odontologist's expertise which will help identify these important pieces of evidence. A normal person who does not examine teeth regularly, it may be difficult for them to examine the locate and identify these fragmented teeth, because they may not look like teeth, they may look like small stones, or they may look, burnt remains might look like pieces of wood. So it is easier for them to miss it. But because a dentist is very he is working with teeth at the smallest level, so he is very much aware of what are the different anatomy of the teeth, and he can easily locate and identify teeth. It is his expertise, so it is very important that in such cases he be called at the site itself along with the other forensic experts. A single tooth, jaw fragment, or even a portion of tooth may be vital to the identification. Postmortem head and neck x-rays may locate dislodged teeth or fragments. X-ray examination of dirt or charred debris may also reveal fragmentary evidence. So such small fragments of teeth can be identified in a big debris or dirt area. If there is a X-ray examination done, it can be easy to locate. Now, conditions of body. As I said earlier, that many times the bodies are visually identifiable, and they are identified visually most of the times, which is I would say against the guidelines or against the scientific rules which have been laid down, that there has to be at least one primary identifier. It is very common to see cases of misidentification being reported in the media, but in spite of that, this practice continues. So dental identification, dental examination should be conducted if there are no reports of a missing person or clues to the identity, no personal effects are found, no fingerprints are on file. Dental examination should proceed with no disfigurement to the face, no resection or removal of the jaws, as the body may be viewed by the relatives. Dental examination would consist of photographs of teeth. So we need to click frontal photographs, buccal aspect and occlusal aspect photographs, dental chart, a full mouth series of standard dental x-rays with a portable dental x-ray machine and impressions of teeth. So this is in case of bodies which are visually identifiable. We try and not to make any incisions or disfigure the face in any way, because the body is visually identifiable and it will be viewed by a relative. So in such cases, if an incision is required for any reason such as rigor mortis, we try to not make it on the face and we make Y-shaped incision which can continue into a regular autopsy, and we raise a flap. So we have to make sure that the procedure we conduct is done in a way so that reconstruction is possible and later on viewing by the family is possible. Restricted opening due to rigor may require intraoral incision of masticatory muscles with or without a fracture of the condyles. Breaking the rigor with bilateral leverage on the jaws in the retromolar region, waiting until the rigor subsides. So if it is not an emergency, you can always wait. Inframandibular dissection with or without the mandibular resection. So an incision can be made from the upper aspect of the neck, upper anterior aspect of the neck, extending towards the mastoid, and a flap can be raised from there. And this can be done even without any mandibular resection. Removal of the larynx and tongue at postmortem may facilitate visual examination of teeth and placement of intraoral films. So skeletonized remains, I believe they are the easiest to work with. They are not messy, they are not smelly. So it is the most convenient remains you could work with. However, in skeletal remains, because the periodontal ligament has been destroyed, the single rooted teeth very often come out from their sockets. These loose teeth should be recovered and replaced in their sockets, especially if you are going to do any radiography. Partially decomposed remains are the most difficult to examine because of the odor, there's presence of flies, you know, maggots, all those things. And it is preferable that we can resect the jaws, as you see in the photograph. If in such cases, if we can resect the jaws, because it is not anyway, you know, the viewable remains. So the relatives are not going to view this. So we can resect jaws in such cases of advanced decomposition. Burnt remains, access to teeth becomes very difficult as the teeth become very fragile because of the high temperatures. Jaw may need to be resected. Caution is advised in resecting heavily burnt or calcined jaws since they are extremely fragile. Fixation with clear acrylic spray is recommended. Being dentist, it is always available to us and we can always use it to stabilize the remains before performing any procedure. Mutilated remains, teeth and jaws may be fragmented and distorted. Recovery of all the teeth may be a problem. Dental evidence may be embedded in other areas of the body and strewn about the area. So a full body radiograph may reveal if there is any dental remains which has been ingested. So in such cases. Sir, I hope I have time. If not, I'll go quicker.
Yes, ma'am. You can continue for 5 to 10 minutes.
Okay. So resection of the jaws, usually in advanced decomposition, severe mutilation. So bodies which can are not going to be viewed or are not viewable anyway to the relatives, in those cases we can consider. However, resection is to be completely avoided. From my point of view, I feel that it is a completely avoidable thing to do, and we should try not to do resection. But if you need to do, you can do it in cases which where there is severe mutilation and in cases of advanced decompositions. It has to be done only when the body will not be viewed by the relatives. Forensic odontologists can accomplish a more complete and comprehensive examination and obtain better quality x-rays, because you know it is independent of the body, so you can work how much ever you want with it, because it's just the jaws. The jaws, if you are going to preserve them, you need to preserve them in 10% formalin. So this is just an example. It is a demo case. It is not an actual case of forensic odontology. Now, photographs, we need to take full face photographs, close up of the teeth. We need to take, as I said, buccal and occlusal aspect of the teeth. And we need to do close-up photography in case if there is any specific feature, or if there is a clearly the shape of the filling visible, we need to do a close-up photography. Radiography is essential for a forensic dental examination. We have to adjust the exposure time depending on the condition of the body. So you will have to practice and play with your equipment a little bit to find out what is the exposure time required for different kind of bodies. In cases of age estimation, we need to do x-ray anyways. Yeah. Notes and charts. So we note down all pertinent information related to dental examination. So it could be the number of teeth which are present, which are missing, if there is any restoration, if there is any filling, any kind of treatment done, prosthesis placed, everything will be noted down. Now, I have just made a list of, this is a basic contents of a kit which should be in, you know, with you, and you can even take this kit to if you're going away for a crime scene, or if you're going away to do a case which is not in your city, so you can carry this with you. Yeah, you can modify this the contents of this kit depending on the type of case you are doing and based on your experience of working. So these are just basic contents: gloves, goggles, mask, then you can have a portable light source, preferably a head torch which is placed in a headband on your forehead, so you this way you are independent with your both your hands. Disposable toothbrushes, cotton buds, swabs, alcohol in a squeezy bottle, mouth props of various sizes, camera with macro lens and ring flash if possible, hand-free lip or cheek retractors, ABFO scales, photography mirrors, mirrors, probes, forceps, small selection of extraction forceps, dental radiographic films, dental film holders, a selection of dental impression trays, additional silicone impression material, some papers, disposable pens, disposable bags, portable light, ultraviolet light, cold cure acrylic. So these are just basic contents. You can add to this or remove some, and you know, and modify this however you want according to your requirement. If possible, try to take casts of the victim's teeth. Now, these are just some findings of the dental treatments. If it is present, you have to discuss the anatomy, shape, the location where it is present, and all those details. Now, with comparison of AM and PM records, I'll just cover some points. The more alterations or the more unique features it is present in the dentition, there is a greater potential for identifying that person. mostly, you know, if someone has no treatment done, they have regularly aligned teeth and, you know, no specific features, it becomes difficult to use that for comparison. However, it doesn't mean that it cannot be compared. There are still unique features, unique anatomical features present, the shape of the roots, the shape of the pulp chamber, trabecular pattern, and the nerves, the sinus, all those things can be still be observed. So the normal anatomy is also useful. A positive identification must bear no unexplainable inconsistencies. So if there are inconsistency between the PM and AM recalls, those should be explainable ones. It should have no unexplainable inconsistencies. There is no specific number of characteristics needed for a positive identification. So there is no specific number that, okay, we need 10 points or we need 5 points to identify this person. Even with a single finding, you can still identify that person, but it depends on how specific that feature is, okay? So even if there is just one filling, but it is a MOD filling or mesio-occlusal distal filling with a specific shape, so that one filling is enough to identify that person, okay? So there is no specific number of points which are required to identify. Whereas if you think of 2-3 occlusal fillings, you know, of a similar nature, these are very common in our population. So it is possible that these three fillings will not be as useful as that one MOD filling. So it depends, you know, case by case basis. And sometimes it depends on how specific, the degree of specificity of that feature. The final decision as to the degree of credibility of dental identification rests with the judgment and experience of a forensic odontologist. So you will get more confident with the more experience you have. Selfie photographs also can be very useful, but I guess there is a lecture on this later on in this conference. This is forensic use of forensic light sources for identification of tooth-colored fillings. As you see, it fluoresces under ultraviolet light. Now, the major problem faced, universal problems which are faced are the large number of human fragmented, commingled and burnt remains. So when there are commingled remains, it becomes very difficult. It becomes a challenge to actually sort out those remains, especially if there are loose teeth lying around, fragmented teeth lying around. It becomes difficult to sort in such kind of cases. Difficulty in determining who was involved in cases of open disasters. Acquisition of useful medical and dental records and radiographs, legal, jurisdictional, organizational, and political issues become unavoidable. Internal and external documentation and communication problems. Sometimes the team which is retrieving antemortem records and team which is retrieving postmortem records, there becomes a communication gap between the two, which can be a challenge. Application of universal human forensic identification codes. So not everyone is well versed, and it becomes difficult in cases where there are untrained people who are part of teams. So it becomes confusing. However, I would like to say that these are global universal problems, and for you can see the meme, it's like for India, it is like my phone is so new and no one makes cover for it. So for us, we have a different set of problems. Hesitation to include a dentist during the ID process. So many times the medical examiners feel that we have been IDing bodies since, you know, we were a kid. Maybe we are doing this since we were 40 years. We have 40 years of experience. We never needed a dentist. Why do we need them now? And all those kind of things. So hesitation to include a dentist in the process. Police not aware about odontology. So many police people, especially who work on the ground, the sub-inspector and constable level people, they don't know what is odontology or even inspector level people. Very few of them will know because of the recent cases which are being done in India. Some may know about it, but most of them, you can, you know, it is an accepted fact. They don't know what is odontology. accessibility to dental records is a problem. Very difficult to obtain antemortem records. It is still possible in areas where there are fewer dentists, but if there are many dentists available in one area now, if in a city like Mumbai, every street has 2-3 dentists. So it becomes very difficult to find who the dentist is and whether they have retained those records. So accessibility to dental records. Family not aware of the dental treatment or records. Families unwilling to hand over dental records. Dentists unwilling to hand over dental records. It should be, I feel, it is high time we accept that many dentists also do not know the legal implications of maintaining dental records. So I think they should be trained at the undergraduate level for the regarding the importance of dental records, not just for forensic purposes, but even for their clinical practice and for protection against allegations of malpractice and negligence. So they should know about it. Illegible dental records, inadequate radiographs, lack of adequate charting. I know of many dentists who will only write down what treatment they are doing. They will not write down other findings. So if the patient has come with chief complaint of pain in the right mandibular region, they will just examine that region and write down caries with 4-6, and they don't care for the rest of the especially if it's a busy practice or what they say, a practice with huge numbers. So in those cases there is inadequate charting, human errors, first premolar, second premolar, sometimes a molar is missing and there is drifting. So in those cases there can be human errors with tooth numbering, lack of uniformity of charting systems, and not following advice of a dentist with dental findings. So many times there is a dental finding where a dentist may give his opinion, but the medical examiner would not be willing to listen to that opinion. So these are some local challenges we face of working in India. Dental records various challenges involved in relation to dental records, which we discussed. But a major one is poor quality radiographs and radiographs which are misplaced or lost. That is a major problem with dental records. Now, these are in relation to the current era which we are in. You have to be very careful. You have to protect yourself against the infection. So always, if you're going for a dental autopsy, always you need to wear your complete PPE and take all the precautions which are possible. I will not go into detail, but there is this paper published which you can recommend, which you can read whenever you have time if you're going for a dental autopsy. And always, it is always a team approach. So it's not, just me alone as an odontologist or just the medical examiner alone, or in case of skeletal remains, just the anthropologist. We need to work together, and it is not only for us, but it is for, the focus is the case, and for solving that case, for doing, completing that ID, for providing, dignified management of the deceased. It is always essential that you work as a team along with other experts. And stay safe, everyone. Thank you for your time. Thank you for listening so patiently to me today.